Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, I welcome you all to this video. We are with the 12th chapter of microwave engineering, where the various microwave passive components we have been addressing so far. So we started with the understanding for the behaviors of E-plane T, H-plane T, the combination of the two called as magic T. Next to that, we have the hybrid rings, directional couplers, hybrid couplers, and now we have been started to see the microwave components. Those are based on the Faraday's rotation principle when the ferrite material is used. So in the previous video, we have gone through the understanding of microwave gyrator, and now based on to the Faraday's rotation principle again for the ferrite material, we have another device. We have microwave circulators. So let us see the details of this device here. So we start here for the topic called as microwave circulators. So I hope it is very, very clear what exactly the Faraday's rotation principle for the ferrite materials is. So the ferrite materials, we have already got it cleared that MnO, ZnO, CdO. So these type of the materials are called as the ferrite materials, which are the non-metal materials having the resistivities of the order of 10 raised to the power 14 as compared to that of the metals. Here we have the permittivity at the relative values to be of 10 to 15 and the relative permeabilities of the order of 1000. So when such ferrite materials are applied by a constant magnetic field, so that time they will be producing a rotation to the orientation of E field vector. In general, they will have the rotation to the linear polarization. So in general, if we have such a circular cross section rod of the ferrite material having the uniformity into the overall length of the material here, so when we have the input of microwave signal fed from this side, so it will have a rotation to its E field vector here as we get it available at output port, port number 2 here. If we give input at port number 2 here, so it will again have the rotation into the same direction as the previous case here. So this is nothing but the Faraday's rotation principle. So as like the microwave gyrator, the microwave circulator is also based on this principle here. Now as the name suggests, here we can guess what can be the behavior of the microwave component. So as the name is microwave circulators, it is of course mean for the circulation of the microwave signal here. So there it is, some kind of circulation from one port to another port. So let us see the detail with one more schematic diagram. So in general, there can be any arbitrary n number of ports if the circulator is designed with the help of the ferrite materials placed to a constant magnetic field there. Now most possibly into the microwave systems, microwave test bench, we find 4-port microwave circulator here. So in this schematic diagram, we consider this opening to the microwave transmission line called as microwave port number 1, or we can get it to microwave port number 2 if we have microwave port number 1 here. So microwave port number 1, 2, port number 3 and port number 4 here. So these ports are connected to the transmission lines that can connect the device with another microwave components for processing of the signal here. Now as general, if we have the input to port number 1 for a microwave signal here, so because of the ferrite material inside, it will have the rotation. So this is the cross sectional view here. So because of this rotation principle of Faraday's, we have the input from port number 1 fed to generate at port number 2. If we have input at port number 2, it will be fed to port number 3 here. If we provide input at port number 3, it will be diverted to generate at port number 4. And when we have input at port number 4, it will be diverted to port number 1 here. So see here, the microwave signal fed to any of the port in this microwave circulator is directed to its adjacent and next number port here. So this is all due to the Faraday's rotation principle observed with the ferrite material here. So in general, how the microwave circulator, four port microwave circulator, the operation can be achieved, this schematic diagram can help you here. So as we require four ports here, we shall be making the use of two waveguides here. So waveguide, a hollow metallic tube, it is having the two openings opposite to each other. So here we shall be considering a primary waveguide. And there it is, another waveguide called as secondary waveguide here. So let us see, for primary waveguide, we have the opening onto the left hand side to be the port number 1 here, whereas onto the right hand side, we have port number 2. For the secondary waveguide, we have the opening onto the left hand side, port number 3, and onto the right hand side, that it is port number 4. So we have here total 4 ports here. Now, along with the primary and secondary waveguide, as the total device will be integrated here, we require the couplers here. You can see here, there it is opening to the common wall between the primary and secondary waveguide. So at the two places, we have the openings here. So here we can call this particular region to be the coupler 1. Whereas the second opening will be regarded to be the coupler 2 here. Along with the primary waveguide, secondary waveguide, with the help of the two couplers here, we also require the two non-reciprocal phase shifters here. So I mentioned here the phase shifter 1 and phase shifter 2 here. So this is 1 and this is 2 here. So in this schematic diagram, we can have the input to port number 1 here. So now we have the mention of 90 degrees, then for omega 1 to be 180 degrees due to the phase shifter 1. For omega 2, the signal fed from port number 2, we have 90 degrees value. For omega 3, we have 0 degrees of phase shift. And for omega 4, we have 90 degrees of phase shift here. So therefore, in this diagram, at this place also we have the 90 degrees. This is for 180 degrees. This is also for 180 degrees in total. So this will be for 270 degrees and 90 degrees here. So this kind of arrangement can also give you the input provided to port number 1 to be generated at port number 2. For port 2, we generate the output at port number 3. For input to port 3, we generate it at port number 4. And for input at port number 4, we get that generated to port number 1. Now the microwave circulator in another form, as like we had for the microwave gyrator, can be shown with the help of this schematic diagram. In this way, we have again the central portion of the microwave circulator component to be of circular waveguide here. So at the center, it has circular cross section, and there it is placed a ferrite rod here, which is tapered at both the ends to have reductions into any kind of attenuations that are unwanted here. The ferrite rod is also, with the help of the fixed type of the magnetic field generated by the permanent magnets, north and the south poles. And due to this arrangement, ferrite material associated with the magnetic field, it will be having the Faraday's rotation principle, and the rotation is by the angle theta is equal to 45 degrees in this case here. Now, at both of the ends, as like the previous case, we have a transition from the circular cross section to that of the rectangular cross sections. So at the left hand side opening and at the right hand side opening, we have a rectangular cross section. So if we have the propagation of microwave signal into the rectangular cross section, so there it is, you see the mode of propagation will be the dominant mode of propagation denoted by transverse electric called TE10. And when it is having propagation into the circular cross section, it will be working as a circular waveguide. The dominant mode into the circular waveguide is TE11 here, transverse electric here. So both of the TE10 in the rectangular waveguide or TE11 in circular waveguide are the dominant modes. Those are offering the lowest value, the least value of the cutoff frequency, or in another words, the maximum value of the cutoff wavelength, as they are inversely proportional to each other. So on to the left hand side, there it is a simple transition from rectangular cross section to that of the circular cross section here. Now, in this particular circular cross section, there it is the another junction that is having the port number 3 that we can denote. This is port number 1 for the dominant mode TE10. These will be the orientations of the E field vector here. Now, this is the ferrite material centrally placed, and later we have the junction with port number 4 that we can show, and the port number 4 is having the angle 45 degree. So there it is a requirement of 45 degree and 45 degree tilt to be generated at this particular port here. Now at the right hand side, at the extreme, we have the port number 2 opening, which is basically having the 45 degrees of tilt into the polarization type as compared to that of the port number 1 here. So this is the structure that we have generated here. So this is port number 1, this is port number 2. So comparing between the two here, it is the line parallel to port number 1 is basically shown by the dashed line, but the structure is as such, we have 45 degrees of tilt here. This is port number 3 and this is port number 4. Now let us talk about the behavior of this device. When we have input of microwave signal from port number 1, so it will be TE11, it will be TE10 mode here. So it will enter from the transition rectangular to the circular, it will be of TE11. So it will be having this kind of orientation, the same orientation here. Now you can see here, the port 3 will not be having the same kind of orientation for the E field vectors here. So there it won't be affecting the propagation of microwave signal. Now it reaches to the ferrite material. It has the rotation by 45 degrees here. Next to that, it again crosses the port number 4. But the orientations of the microwave signal will not be aligned to the structure that has been for the port number 4. So port number 3 and port number 4 will not be having any cuttings to the microwave signal that has been propagating input at port number 1. So finally it reaches to the port number 2 here. When we provide the port number 2 with the input microwave signal, now it crosses port number 4. There it won't be any kind of the crossing or cutting to the microwave signal. It crosses the ferrite material here. So here we have already the 45 degrees of the shift due to the structure here at the opening port number 2. Ferrite material. So this 2 will be affecting as such, the orientation of the E field vectors will be aligned to that of the port number 3. Hence the output will be generated at port 3 here. And when we have the port number 3 used as the input port, so that time it is as such generated that the port number 4 will be generating the output. And for port number 4 to be the input here, it will generate the output at port number 1 here. So this was all the behavior of the 4-port microwave circulator we have discussed so far. Let us address few of the selected applications that the microwave circulator is popular for. So in this application, the microwave circulator is used for the duplexer purpose here. So the duplexer is basically the use of same antenna for the transmission as well as the reception purpose here. For the duplexer purpose, we have already used the magic tee also. Now the magic tee is also a 4-port device and circulator is also a 4-port device. So this is the simple arrangement using the microwave circulator for the duplexer purpose here. To the port number 1, we have the radar transmitter designated by this block. To the port number 2, we have the use of antenna connected with the help of transmission line. To the port number 3, we have the radar reception section here, whereas the port number 4 is connected to a match type of the termination here so that there won't be any kind of reflections here. Now, as you know, the behavior of the microwave circulator that has been at the center here, the input to the port number 1, so it will be a signal fed from the radar transmission signal. It will be provided to port number 2. So that time it will be having the output from this antenna, and this antenna will be working as the radiating antenna, transmitting antenna. So the signal will be fed to the nearby wireless medium for the intended radiation here. Now when the same port number 2 is used as input port, so this antenna has to receive certain signal from the nearby space here. Earlier it was giving the output here, now it is receiving the input here. So this received signal will not be fed to the radar transmitter section because of the ferrite material at the center. So the signal will be diverted from port 2 to port number 3, where there it is connected the radar receiver section that will have the certain processing units for the signal that has been just now received here. If we provide the input from port number 3, it will be going to the match termination, no reflections, and for input at port number 4, it will be fed as input and diverted to the radar transmitter section to port number 1. So this way the microwave circulator having the 4 ports can be used as microwave duplexer purpose here. Now in one of our previous chapters where we have the generation of microwave signal based on to the semiconductor platforms, we have learned through the tunnel diodes and the parametric amplifiers here. So with the help of these devices, the 3-port microwave circulators can also be used. The application can be summarized with the help of this schematic diagram. So in this schematic diagram, you can see here the tunnel diode is connected to one of the port of a 3-port microwave circulator here. So this is the one port, you can say. This is the another port from where the input can be fed, and this is the third port here. So the total 3 ports here. At the center there used to be a ferrite material, and due to the magnetic field into the existence, it will be having the circulation of the microwave signal from this port to this to this here, and here it will be fed to the another 3-port circulator. So this is one port of second 3-port circulator having the rotation due to the ferrite material. It will be given to this particular port as output, and this is the third port that has been connected to the match terminated load here. So this particular circuitry will be providing the amplified signal as the output here. Now talking about one of the limitation of the 4-port microwave circulator, or in general N-port microwave circulator. Microwave circulators can handle the low power microwave signal. Hence, whatever the low power microwave signal applications will be there, the microwave circulators can be used for them only. Now, let us have another thing where the microwave circulator can be obtained by the use of two microwave hybrid teas here. So, hybrid teas are also called as the magic teas. So, here in this schematic diagram, we have the two magic teas used here. So, just recall the microwave hybrid tea here where we have the four ports. I name the two collinear ports. This is port number one. Whereas the opposite side, port number two, it is there. This is the side arm designated by port number three, which is basically H arm here. So port number one, two, and three, they all constitute H plane T that exhibits the additive property. Whereas this is the another microwave junction to the collinear arm pair. So this is denoted by port number 4 and which is basically E plane T here. So port number 1, port number 2 and port number 4, they all form E plane T behavior exhibiting the subtractive property here. So it is the same case for the another type of the magic T. So I just name here 1, 2, 3 and 4. So these are the port designations if you consider individual magic T's here. Now we have to make the use of this arrangement, the two magic T's connected in this particular fashion along with the help of a phase shifter. So for this block we have 180 degree of non-reciprocal phase shift in this particular direction. So I mention here phase shifter here. Now the four ports of magic T1 and another four ports of magic T2, so all we have eight ports. So we have to make the arrangement as such the four port circulation can be made possible. So for that purpose we take only this port to be regarded as port number one of microwave circulator. The port number two of microwave circulator can be this one, which is the third port of magic T1 here. The port number three of microwave circulator can be this one. So I name here port number three, which is basically the fourth port of magic T2 here. Whereas we have the last, that it is fourth port of microwave circulator to be the fourth port of magic T1 here. Now we can see here, if this is the microwave circulator port 1 and we provide input to it. You see, this is the H arm of the magic T and H arm property is that the microwave signal will be divided into the two equal magnitudes having the same kind of phase. So one signal will be coming to this arm and another signal with the equal magnitude and same phase will be available at this particular arm here. So these two signals will be propagating over these two lines and will be paid as input to port number 2 and port number 1 of first magic T here without any kind of phase shift. You can note here that the phase shift is only in this direction, left hand side to right hand side direction. Our signal has come from right to left, so with no changes here. Now these are the two collinear ports of the magic T1 here, and it is very well known that if we have the two equal magnitude same phase inputs at port number 1 and 2 of the magic T, they will be added up and the added output will be available at the port of H arm. This is the port 3 of magic T1, which is basically the port 2 of microwave circulator. So the input at port number 1 will be generated at port number 2 here. Now when we provide input to this port, again because of the H arm property, they will be splitted at these two branches with equal magnitude and same phase. Now it is running through this branch left to right, so it will be affected by 180 degree of phase shift. This will be the same here. So this will be coming to the port number 2 of magic T2 and this is to the port number 1 of magic T1 here. Now these two inputs are having the equal magnitudes, but now at this branch we have a phase shift by 180 degrees. Now you know that when the two inputs at port 1 and 2 of the magic tees are there with equal magnitude but phase shift of 180 degree, so the magic tee will be behaving as like the E plane tee here. So there it will be the added output at arm number 4, which is basically the E plane arm here. So this we have used as port number 3 here. So input to port number 2 has resulted into the output at port number 3, the complete circuitry, the arrangement as microwave circulator here. Now if we provide input to this port, so that time it will be having a split up into these two arms here with a phase shift of 180 degree. So now these will be running here, so this phase shifter will not be affecting the signal from right hand side to the left hand side. So we have the phase shifted output at this particular port due to the E plane T property here, and non phase shifted input at this two. So again it will be acting as E plane T and will be producing the output at port number 4 here. So this was all with respect to the microwave circulator, which is basically, if you have to have construction with the help of the ferrite material, it will be of course working on to the Faraday's rotation principle, but with the help of the two magic tees and a phase shifter we can also make the same thing constructed there. So this was the microwave circulator. By the next lecture we shall be practicing a simple problem based on to all this understanding here. So I hope you enjoy learning the microwave engineering subject and its corresponding topics. For more such information and the knowledge, you can subscribe to Ekeeda channel. Thank you.